I call this meeting of the Clinton Township Board of Appeals for Wednesday, January 20th, to order. All rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. Led by Mr. Pearl today.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America.
The Republic for which it stands.
Which it stands.
Under God.
Indivisible. Liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Mr. Campbell, roll call, please.
Mr. Alexander.
Present.
Campbell's here. Mr. Diak.
Here.
Mr. Bartolomeo.
Here.
Mr. Merrill's excused. Mr. Merrill.
Here.
Mr. Pearl.
Here.
Also in attendance is Mr. Bruce Thompson, the director of the Department of Planning and Community Development for Clinton Township.
Thank you, Mr. Campbell. Before I do the normal announcements, we have a agenda before us, and I understand there's some changes to that agenda. Number one, we're going to be tabling, postponing Union Lake Villas. Is that true, Mr.? Where are you?
Yeah, that's actually what the request is, Mr. Diak. So okay. you don't need to change the agenda because of that item. That's okay. Actually what the specific request is.
Thank you. And then number four, we are going to to postpone that to next month to both Mr. Campbell and Mr. Diak and see if we get reappointed. So can I get a motion for the amended agenda?
Well, are we going to amend it, or are we just going to vote on postponing those items when they come to them? Which, Mr. Chairman, which?
Well, I think we should take number four and postpone that one. And then number one we can. I really don't mind. Usually we amend the agenda, don't we, Bruce?
Yeah, you can. I think number one, again, you can leave on get a vote. But number four, you can approve an amended agenda or postponing number four to the next meeting. That's appropriate. Okay?
So moved. Okay? Yeah, so moved.
Who's supporting?
Support by Campbell.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Aye. Motion carried. Okay, here we go. Got a few things to read here. The first item is ZBA virtual meeting. As a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, Public Act 228 of 2020, MCLA 15.263, Section 3A, provides authority authorizing remote participation in public meetings in order to avoid person-to-person contact. Prior to the current Zoning Board of Appeals meeting, a dedicated email address has been established directing your emails to the Zoning Board, which allows you to contact them via email to provide your input with regard to the agenda items and ask questions prior to the meeting. The email is zba@township-mi.gov. Throughout the meeting and on agenda items, your emails relating to the specific agenda item will be read prior to the Zoning Board voting on each agenda item. Further, following consideration of all agenda items, persons who have connected remotely will be permitted to speak. Existing rules regarding public participation otherwise fully apply. Next one is public comment. The chairperson should call all persons wishing to address the board during the public comment to the microphone. Oh, yeah, change that, Bruce. And request their name and address for the record. Comments will be limited to 3 minutes. Comments by persons must be confined to Zoning Board of Appeals business. Meaning topics over which the Zoning Board of Appeals has authority and which involve Zoning Board of Appeals matters. Should the board decide a response to a specific question raised by persons at the public comment section is needed, The board shall refer the question to the Planning and Community Development Department Director or designee for review. Okay, the last one. The Board of Appeals functions as a quasi-judicial body with specific powers and limitations as outlined in various sections of the zoning ordinance and the state statutes. The zoning ordinance states that standards the board must use in reaching any decision. Once a decision of the board becomes final, only the courts can modify or reverse that decision. This board is not empowered to change the terms or intent of an ordinance. Therefore, you must petition the Township Board of Trustees if you wish to amend an ordinance. Before a variance can be granted, certain requirements must be satisfied. Number one, practical difficulty must be demonstrated. Number two, whether strict compliance with area, setbacks, frontage, height, bulk, or density would unreasonably prevent the owner from using the property for a permitted purpose or would render conformity unnecessary burdensome. Number three, whether a variance would do substantial justice to the petitioner as well as to other property owners in the district, or whether a lesser relaxation given substantial relief would be more consistent with justice to others. And number four, whether the plight of the owner is due to unique circumstances of the property. Thank you for allowing me to read all those. Hold on, where am I? Who's beeping on me? Okay, with that being said, Mr. Campbell, item number one.
First item on the agenda is Union Lake Villas, which is vacant land on Union Lake. This is an item postponed from September 16th, 2020 and November 18th, 2020. Purpose of the item on the agenda tonight is to discuss petitioner's request to table this application. There was no mailing on this and naturally no replies received. I'll leave the details of that for the discussion.
Okay, any discussion from the audience? Any emails, Mr. Thompson?
None.
With that, discussion at the board, Mr. Pearl?
Yes, we're receipt of a letter dated January 4th from the petitioner asking us to table this item to allow additional time for research. Mr. Thompson, is that just to postpone until they're ready, or do you want a definite date?
No, we don't want a definite date. My discussions with the petitioner is he's going to be out of town for at least a couple months and was not really prepared to say, give me 30 days, give me 60 days. So what I spoke to him about, because he as well, as you saw from that, wanted to do some research to just table the item. If and when he's ready to bring it back, we will renotice it and we'll get it back on the agenda. But till then, setting it for another date, it's this repetitive returning back to the board with nothing. He and I agreed that's just not necessary at this point.
Then, Mr. Chairman, I'll move that we table this item until such time as the petitioner gets with our planning department to bring it back.
Is there a second to that motion?
I'll support.
Moving seconded. Any further comment from the board? Any other emails?
No, sir. None.
With that, roll call vote.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Merrill, I think you spoke before I did in the second.
Yeah. Okay. Yep. Yes, sir.
Campbell, yes. Mr. Alexander?
Yes.
Mr. Bartolomeo?
Yes.
Mr. Diak?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you, Mr. Campbell. Next item on the agenda.
Next item is the petitioner is Thad Drum at 20134 McKitchney. Purpose of the request is to permit the continuance of an existing 920 square foot addition to an accessory structure for a single family home in the R5 one family residential district, exceeding the total combined maximum square footage of 1,770 square feet allowed by a variance granted by the Zoning Board of Appeals on July 25th, 2018. There were 39 letters sent to owners and occupants within 300 feet. Three were returned as undeliverable. No written replies were received.
Thank you, Mr. Campbell. Mr. Thompson, any emails on this issue?
None.
Is the petitioner here? Thad, are you there, Mr. Drum?
Yes, I am. Can you hear me, board members?
We can. State your name and address for the record and present your case, sir.
My name is Thad Drum. My wife, Karen, is behind me. My address is 20134 Clinton Township, 48035.
What's the street name?
I did submit a brief synopsis to Lisa Wolf on the emails, and she said she would submit that to the file. I don't know if that was ever received.
Mr. Thompson?
I believe that everything we got was forwarded to the board.
Okay. Oh. Go ahead, Mr. Drum.
Okay, well, the skinny of it is I wasn't trying to get away with something sneaky. I just wanted to put an awning or a carport over part of my driveway and didn't think it was going to be. When I talked to Jim, the building inspector, he said that that actually increases the footprint of the whole structure. And I didn't see that coming. So, like, excuse me. Then, what do we do now? He explained that we have to go through this process that we're all going through right now. Anyway, it's just a carport that extends over the part of my driveway. And then I went further and I dropped a curtain down in front of it. So, which doubles as keeping any sideways rain from coming through. And of course, hides my cars and trailers out of public eye. So it actually really cleans up the front of the property there in front of all the whatchamacallit though. So I thought it was, I was trying to make it look the nicest so everyone would be pleased. No one would have a grievance against it. I didn't see the problem with the footprint increasing. Like I said, he said it's like a 920 feet increase above what was allotted for the actual garage that was built and approved and all. Everything went fine with that. But when I, during the COVID break, I was off work for 7 weeks. I put a little, well, not little, I put a big awning up or a carport. And then Jim just happened to be driving by. He noticed it and then he brought to my attention. So it's all the problem of getting a yet an additional variance for what I had already erected. Now it's just a roof with trusses and curtains, effectively nylon tarps. They don't look like the crappy blue tarp or something you just buy at the builder store. It's actually a heavy piece of nylon that I managed to get colored the same shade as the rest of the structure. So it all looks homogeneous. It all looks blended really nicely. But yes, that's the way we stand.
Okay.
Does the board members or anybody get a chance to see what it looks like during the last couple months?
We all have to go out and look at it. Is there anything further you'd like to add to that? I see you, Mr. Cam. Hold on a minute.
I think that does cover it.
All right. Let me open this. Anybody in the audience that would like to speak to this matter? Is there anybody in the audience that would like to speak to this matter? Okay, hearing none, open it up to the board. Mr. Campbell, you had your hand up first.
Thank you. I've got several concerns on this. Looking back at the meeting in 2018, where we granted the variance for the 1,770 square foot structure. Looking at that, there was no discussion at all about a second story because that would be require a variance for the existence of second story. But looking at the garage, I see a door up on where the second story would be. So it appears that a second story has been put in there without getting approval for it. I can't imagine there'd be a door for any other reason. And I guess the other one is I question whether we can even grant a variance for this carport. The looking at the township zoning ordinance, that, let me just read one paragraph. In 1298.01b, it says, in one-family residential districts, each dwelling shall be limited to two detached accessory buildings, providing that the combined total floor area of the detached buildings shall not exceed 650 square feet, or one-half the floor area of the principal dwelling, or 2% of the total land area of the lot or parcel, whichever is greater. And that's the basic criteria that we followed and on the basis for which we granted the previous variance. However, it goes on and says, in no instance shall a combined floor area of the detached accessory buildings exceed 2,500 square feet. And therein, this is the first time we've ever encountered this. And I read that just to suggest that we really cannot grant a variance for any totals of accessory structures over 2,500 square feet. In fact, we never have. There's the largest accessory structure in Clinton Township that we've granted a variance for in the last 25 years is at about 2,300 square feet. The 920 for the carport added onto the current 1770 is a total of 2,690 square feet. So with my conclusion from that is that unless we get approval from the township attorney, I don't think we could validly grant a variance for the structure with the carport.
Thank you, Mr. Campbell.
Well, first, in reference to your mention about the second floor, the loft, according to statutes we read across, was the actually, if it's below a certain limit of, I think, 6'2" or whatever, it wasn't called considered living space and was fine because they don't want people living above garages, apparently. So I just keep it underneath that limit. It's not a second floor livable space. It's just a loft storage area, which is where I keep a bunch of carports, car parts, and extra storage space for that sort of thing. The in regards to the actual addition of the carport, like I previously mentioned, I didn't see that increasing the footprint of the whole building. I mean, there's got no walls. It's just a corrugated steel roof with some mighty trusses and poles into the ground. Mighty poles. I tried to overbuild it to avoid any issues. But like I say, I thought it was like an awning or something that just sticks off of your house, or like, you know, a porch, something that's attached to it. But Jim explained to me that if it's attached to the structure, it becomes part of the structure. So then I'm left at the point where I can change it and have it not connected to my structure. And that way it's a separate something, or I could tear the roof off of it. And then it's just a trellis for my grapevines. There's a lot of grapes in the yard. And this acre lot is surrounded by grapevines, as long as other many other vines, ivy even. So I mean, ideally it would work best for me if I were to be allowed to keep the roof as opposed to tearing it off. And that's where I sit with the request. But like I said, I wasn't aware that it would increase the footprint, that an awning or a carport would increase the footprint of the property. I mean, let's say my house, I had a big awning or a carport sticking off of the house. Would that increase the footprint of the house? Like when I sell it, it's a, you know, 1,000 extra square foot feet. I just didn't see that coming. Mr. Campbell, you had your hand.
Well,
let me paraphrase my question. Can you give me a good reason why you should have by 350 square feet the largest set of accessory structures of any lot in Clinton Township?
Honestly, don't see a problem with it. A matter of principle or a matter of privilege, I couldn't say. But what I can say is that it looks better on the lot than seeing the number of cars and trailers that I have. So anybody driving by or any of my neighbors that see me on a regular basis would probably be appreciative of it.
Can I ask,
Mr. Campbell, go ahead.
The number of vehicles that you have. When you applied for the variance back in 2018, what's in the minutes? Because it said you had five vehicles and that your wife had one that she drove. That's a total of six. Now it's showing up that you have a total of 10, which is four more vehicles than you had 2 years ago.
I honestly don't know where those numbers would have came from, because I actually got rid of cars since then. My wife has always had two for the last 5 years. I've had at least five over the years. Last year, okay, I got rid of two cars, but I gained two cars, so that worked out even. And one of my cars I owned, I bought for my mother, and so that's at a different location anyway.
I'm just talking the meetings and what's in your application. Your application says there's a total of 10 vehicles now.
Yeah, I think it's including the one that's that bought for my mother. I bought her a Jaguar, and that's at her house, and she uses that there. It's technically under my name, so when I'm asked if I have, you know, how many cars I have, technically I do own that. It's in my name. But yeah, on the property, the my wife's cars are both in the pre-existing garage. The garage I built a couple years ago or last year finished. Holds only four.
Why do you need so many?
I'm a car enthusiast. And I like, well, they're all classics. They range from 69, 73, 74, 75, 78. And yeah, they're all like classic cars, half of which are being restored.
Bottom line is, I personally am not convinced that this is the right thing to do in a single family residential area. And I personally feel like a clearance from the township attorney on whether we can even grant a variance for something totaling more than 2,500 square feet. I think that would be the appropriate step at this point. That's personal opinion.
Thank you, Mr. Campbell.
Yeah, I wish. Apparently, it's not really possible, but I wish we can get away from that carport being a whole addition to the structure. If it was like a whole addition, I could have walls on it and a functioning garage door. It would be a very different animal from what it is right now. But if that's the way the statute reads, I mean, I guess I can't get around it, except for getting a variance. Mr. Michael Dalek, did you have a...
Anybody else from the zoning board would like to speak to this? Mr. Merrill?
I'm just trying to figure out what the practical difficulty is here. You know, I can sympathize with being a car enthusiast and wanting to be able to, you know, to be able to work on cars and different things, but I just don't see a hardship that isn't, you know, that's included by the space that you're in. It's, to me, it's a self induced hardship that because of the amount of cars you have. I think that I'm with Mr. Campbell that I would like to see, you know, the advice of the township attorney on whether or not this variance can even be granted. You know, outside of being a car enthusiast and having a lot of cars, is there really another hardship that's there in place?
Well, I would say the hardship of the multiple thousands of dollars I put into building in the first place and then having the effort to have to tear everything down again, that would be an unfortunate hardship. However, I mean, I do admit that of my ignorance of the regulations, the way they work about increasing the footprint of the structure, I was unaware of that. But of course, that doesn't change that it actually does exist. Worst case scenario, I tear off the roof and then it's not a structure anymore. Just trusses and poles, trellis for my grapevines.
Yeah, I agree with Mr. Merrill. I don't see where the practical difficulty is here. And financial reasons and self-imposed is not one, which I stated in the beginning of the meeting. I also concur with Mr. Campbell. I think we need to get Jack Doan, our township attorney's opinion on this. So, anybody else would like Mr. Pearl? Mr. Pearl, turn your mic on, please.
Thank you. Before we ask for the attorney's opinion, maybe we ought to vote whether we want to even issue this. In 2018, he came through with the same similar argument, needing additional garage square footage, which now he has, 1,770 square feet. So this continues again. It's not really, having a commercial carport in a residential area really doesn't fit very well. So,
Mr. Thompson.
I'm not the township attorney, and I do not purport to be, but I can tell you, in my opinion, any property owner has the right to request a variance from any section or any requirement of the zoning ordinance. It does not allow the board to pick and choose. If there are certain specific items that your zoning ordinance says a variance cannot be granted for, that would be different. But in my estimation, it's a requirement like any other in the zoning ordinance, and they have the right to request that. It'd be no different than like a sign ordinance saying, well, you can't have any more than 200 square feet of signage. Even though there's all the precursors up to X amount for wall-mounted signage, it kind of equates to the same thing in my mind. Not saying you shouldn't get an attorney's opinion if you want one, but in my experience, that's what I feel. Thank you.
Anybody else from the zoning board like to speak to this matter?
Yes, Bruce, a question.
I'm sorry. Okay, Mr. Campbell.
This is worded quite differently. Because it provides what the restriction is on based on the house size and the lot size, and those are the ones that we typically use to grant a variance. But then it goes on with totally different language than what we see in other parts of the zoning ordinance, when it says in no conditions can it exceed 25 square feet. So that's why I have to wonder if that's to be considered like an absolute max, as what could be given.
Bruce, you're going to say something. You're thinking.
No.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
I understand what Mr. Campbell is saying, but it does not say a variance cannot be granted for a structure over 2,500 square feet. And so I think, while it is setting a maximum, I get that, and it is a separate sentence from the first sentence. I still, in my experience, property owner has the right to request a variance from any section of the zoning ordinance, and it's a requirement of the zoning ordinance. So again, I'm not saying you shouldn't get a legal opinion. I just felt that I should at least give you my opinion.
Mr. Pearl, thank you, Mr. Thompson. Mr. Pearl, you got your hand up.
I hear what everybody's saying, but I think it comes back down to do we want to grant this to begin with? You know, if the board doesn't want to grant the variance, then there's no reason to go to the attorney for an opinion.
Well, you're free to make a motion, sir.
Well, I'd like to hear from some of the other board members.
Okay.
In my opinion, this should not be granted, because this would give this particular homeowner 300 and more than 300 square feet more than the next largest set of accessory structures in Clinton Township. I don't see a justification, maybe just because he has more cars or whatever, but I don't think that's a valid reason to go to a number like 2,600 and square. Some odd square feet, when the biggest one currently approved in the township is 2,300.
Thank you, Mr. Campbell. Mr. Merrill, you had your hand up.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think Mr. Pearl really kind of hit the nail on the head, so to speak. Obviously I wasn't on the board in 2018, but if a variance was granted for an accessory structure outside of the normal sizes, and a variance was granted for the storage of the vehicles, I would assume that the petitioner should have known that in this situation, it's not going to more than likely be a success because of the fact that we've already granted this variance once for this structure, but now it was just added on to. And to me, again, I just find the hard, you know, the practical difficulty kind of invalid or null and void. You know, so, you know, unfortunately, you know, I want to be as supportive as we can of our, the people of the township, but I'd make a motion. Well, Mr. Thad, did you have a, or Mr. Drum, did you have a point you wanted to make?
Yeah, go ahead, Mr. Drum.
Yeah, with regard to your statement, I had actually asked for a little more, and it got chopped down, so it became a smaller building than I was originally asking for. And that's fine because I was able to get at least four cars in there and enough shop tools space that I can still work on them. I didn't think that this additional carport would be considered an extra structure to begin with. I didn't think it was going to require a variance. So this is kind of a surprise. And like what I said, the original a couple of years ago when I asked for the original variance, I made point to mention that this is, I'm 50 years old. My wife's the same age as me. This is our final house. We're going to die in this house, whether it's 2 years or 20 years from now. And I bought a house with an acre plot thinking I wasn't going to have any problem building a structure on there that can accommodate my needs. And then, of course, I was, you know, surprised. And when you're buying a house, you don't have enough time to check the city's or township's ordinances before someone else puts a bid in and buys the house out from underneath you. And we've been looking for 6 months to a year, just not finding much out there. We found a lot of houses that had big structures on them already, but didn't have a yard to speak of. So it's like, wow, there's like 100 square feet of yard and 2,000 square feet of structure. And I thought, oh, that's really weird. I didn't think they had the runoff requirements for it. And this is when I was looking around in Roseville and Clinton Township and all the cities in the area. When we found this one, hey, I got a whole acre, lots of trees, which I love, wildlife even. And but I just said, okay, I got to build a structure here. Well, the house was inexpensive enough for me to be able to afford to build a structure. And that's how I walked myself into this trap, if you will, where I got snared with these difficulties with requiring these ordinances and whatnot, or these, variances. So that's the position I find myself in. If I have to take it down, I'll probably just end up taking the roof off. So it will no longer be considered a structure. It's just a trellis or for my grapevines.
No, and you know, I think you kind of made the point for me. Back in 2018, you had requested something larger, and at that time, the board had, you know, indicated that it needed to be smaller, which again, I think we're still in that same position now. You know, one of the other things that you mentioned, you know, you're talking a 2,700 square foot structure. I mean, I understand that you're 1770 at the moment. That's bigger than some of the houses here in Clinton Township. You know, and you're looking for an additional accessory structure. I mean, again, you know, I totally can understand you know, just be comforting in the fact that, you know, you're trying to be a, you know, a proper citizen, block everything from sight of view from your neighbors. But again, I just come back to the fact that I just don't see a hardship here that I am comfortable with granting. So I would make a motion to deny this request, you know, based on the fact that there isn't any other hardship outside of, you know, self-incurred.
I'll support that motion. Second
it. Okay, we have a motion on the floor and a second. Further comment from the board?
Oh, me? Okay.
Any emails, Mr. Thompson?
None. Thank you.
Okay. Got a motion and a second. Roll call vote. Oh, Mr. Sorry, I didn't see you down there, Mr. Drum.
Yeah, I was raising my hand. I just want to say that I never understood why what's wrong with someone living in a tiny house and having a big secondary structure. If that's where, if they're living alone, hey, I have a loan. I need a bathroom and a bedroom and a living room. And then I have a big garage because that's where their heart is. And, but for some reason, no one wants to see that in their neighborhood. No one wants to see a little house and a big garage. And I always thought that was strange why cities and stuff would impose that ruling on you. I go, well, why, what's wrong with having that? Why doesn't my secondary structure have to be half the size of my house? My house is kind of small. And so that kind of, if I build a bigger house, I can have a bigger garage. Does that make any sense to anybody? I always thought it was like strange the way, and let's say it ends up being the largest secondary structure in the Clinton Township. What's wrong with that? I don't see that it's a bad thing to be or have, or if it's just something I don't deserve the privilege to, I suppose that's an argument, but I just don't understand why it's such an issue. Speaking of runoff for civil engineering, yes, I have plenty of runoff. I have an acre of land, and it's already a driveway, which already killed the runoff there anyway. So I have a carport over an existing driveway. It wouldn't change the civil part of it at all. And it's just this concept of society and therefore the ruling planning boards decide that what you're allowed to have. I guess it's just my last closing argument.
Thank you, Mr. Drum. Motion on the floor, roll call vote.
Mr. Merrill?
Yes.
Mr. Campbell, yes. Mr. Alexander?
Oh, yes.
Mr. DeBartolomeo?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Diak?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Thank you. Next agenda item.
Next agenda item. Faith Baptist Church. Faith Baptist Church and School. Located at the corner of 15 Mile and Little Mac Avenue. Purpose of the request, I forget how many items there, is to permit the redevelopment of a site for a church and school in the R5 One Family Residential District, Faith Baptist Church, formerly known as Vacant, with one.
University shut down.
Yep.
And Bob Campbell was the guy that.
Are you sure you're
oh, right? Crap. I'm not.
Okay. With one ingress and egress from a street that does not have an 86-foot wide right-of-way, which is required, and two, parking in the east front yard and north and west street side yards, which is not permitted. There were 187 letters sent to owners and occupants within 300 feet. 12 were returned as undeliverable. No written replies were received.
Thank you, Mr. Campbell. Mr. Thompson, do we have any emails on this issue?
None.
Okay. All right. Now the screens are real small. Is the petitioner here?
I am.
Who's that, Chris?
Tim Berlin.
Tim, sorry. Okay. Tim, a name and address for the record.
My home address is 37680 Joanne Drive, Clinton Township, Michigan, 48036.
Thank you, sir. Go ahead and state your case, please.
Well, I think that there's a practical difficulty in the fact that the, I know you put the diagram up there a second. I'm guessing you all have it in front of you or access to it. But the parking is along 15 Mile. And for our Christian school, we need to have a soccer field. And it just doesn't seem a very good idea to put a soccer field next to a busy road like 15 miles. So it makes most sense to put it back where it is, which will limit the amount of parking back there. And really, we won't use all of that parking, you know, all of the time. But for the Christian Day School, as well as the future preschool that will be starting, and then of course the Sunday services and Wednesday night services will only use a fraction of the parking. All of those things do not go on at the exact same time. So, you know, with the parking where it is and there's no other place to put parking, it presents a practical difficulty, but yet a easy solution to just simply allow the parking to be where it is.
Okay, is there anything else you would like to add to that?
I have my architect on here as well. Jeff Fruata. Jeff, is there anything else you think we need to add?
So based on the new calculation of the use that we have and the amount of parking spaces that are existing, when we take out the number of parking spaces that we have the requirement for, we still have more parking spaces than we're required to have by the ordinances. So that I'm Jeff Ferwetta, Sedgwick and Ferwetta Architects, 410 East Court Street, Flint, Michigan, 48503, if you need that for the record.
Yes, I do. Thank you, sir. Okay, anything else, sirs? Okay, I'm going to open it up to anybody from the audience would like to speak to this matter.
Yes, I would.
Okay. Go ahead, Chris.
Hey, my name's Chris Shornack, and I'm at 21307 Abram Street, which is one of the streets next to the property there. And I'm actually just tuning in to say I'm all for it. What a great addition that's going to be to the neighborhood. I'm also heavily invested in the neighborhood as a landlord, and I have several properties there. I just think this is going to be great for the community. I actually do own a house on Sharkey Street, which is right there east of the Baker College there. And whenever I have tenants move in there, I tell them, and that's what's behind the fire department there. I say, this is the quietest street. It's a very quiet street. Hardly any traffic comes down it. But just wanted to say I'm really happy to see the building's going to be used, and for what a great purpose. And it's going to be a huge asset to the neighborhood and community there.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else from the audience would like to speak to this matter? One more time, anybody else from the audience like to speak for this matter? Seeing none, Mr. Campbell, get your hand up first.
Yeah. I think in this case, the very practical difficulty is the fact this is a reuse of an existing structure, and without all kinds of major renovations or reuse of the parking lot or whatever, I think it would be practically impossible to meet the requirement for the church and school, as well as meet all the requirements of the ordinance. At the same time, I also would like to, talking directly to Mr. Thompson, I would suggest that the Department of Planning and Community Development take a good look at the requirement the churches have to be on these larger sized roads. It doesn't apply to schools, but it does apply to churches. And the interesting part is, for the most part, schools have more times when a large volume of traffic is coming out than do churches. Churches typically might have maybe a total of 3-4 on a weekend and a few smaller meetings during the week. Schools have, if we're back to normal in-person schooling, we're back to at least 5 times a week. So I really think that part of the ordinance needs to be looked at. And this is really a very great reuse of an existing facility. So I see no reason not to grant the variance.
Thank you, Mr. Campbell. Mr. Pearl, I see your hand up.
Yeah, you know, I agree with the resident and Mr. Campbell. I think it's a good use of the property, and because of existing conditions, they really don't have any choice but to ask for these variances to be able to develop this site as a church and school. So now, if it's all right with you, Mr. Chairman, I'll move that we approve the variances as requested due to the existing development of the property and the way it's the parking and everything's already located there.
I'll second that.
Who supported?
I support it.
Is there any further comments from the board? Mr. Merrill.
Thank you. Just want to say I think that this is a fantastic undertaking. I'm excited for the kids in the neighborhood as well. being able to get out on soccer field, run around, try and get off some screens. I think that any time that we can encourage that, we need to. You know, and I do agree that the practical difficulty is that it's an existing facility that has been repurposed or is being looking to be reused instead of vacant. So, you know, I appreciate everybody's looking at this the right way.
Thank you, sir. Mr. DiBartolomeo.
I just want to not so much reiterate what Mr. Merrill said, but on the Planning Commission, we had all the same thoughts. They were in front of us last week, and all the thoughts that have been mentioned tonight were the same thing that was mentioned last week. So we're all in agreement with this, and we wish Mr. Berlin the best of luck. We know that with this, you're hoping to expand the school because you have a bigger building and all, and we want to see nothing but prosperous things going on in this community. So we're all behind you there.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ron. Is there anybody else from the plan from the zoning board that I speak to the matter? Mr. Thompson, any emails?
None.
Okay, hearing none. Seeing none. Roll call vote, Mr. Campbell.
Mr. Farrell?
Yes.
Mr. Campbell, yes. Mr. Bartolomeo?
Yes.
Mr. Merrill?
Yes.
Mr. Alexander?
Votes yes.
Mr. Radiak?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. You're approved, guys.
Hey, thank you very much.
Very good luck. Wish you well.
Thank you.
Item number four has been postponed to next month. And is there any public comments? Mr. Thompson, any public comments?
Nothing on email, no.
Is there anybody in the audience that would like to speak in public comments? I don't see anybody, and I don't hear anybody. Let's go on to the report of meetings, approval of the meeting of December 16, 2020. Mr. Campbell.
Yeah, two small changes I'd request. On page three of the second paragraph under the item involving Iroquois, the second line paragraph, it starts Miss Ashley Gooch. The second line reads, "Are trying to something for their dogs." I think the word "build" needs to be inserted between "to" and "something." And also on page five, the very bottom line, Camaro is, which is name of a car, is spelled C-A-M-E-R-O. I believe the proper spelling is C-A-M-A-R-O.
Duly noted.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have a motion to approve the minutes.
So moved.
Support. Support.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Mr. Thompson, meeting schedule confirmation of meeting for Wednesday, February 17th. Bruce, you want to turn your mic on, sir?
Sorry, I can confirm we will have a meeting. I just cannot confirm for you right at this moment what those items will be. I believe we have two items. So.
Okay, sounds good. With that, motion to adjourn.
So move.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion, meeting adjourned. Thanks everybody for your participation tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Gentlemen, take care.
Good night all. Take care, everybody.
All right.